All right, I believe we are live. Thanks everyone for showing up. We do a SAFRE community stand-up the second Thursday of every month. We feature everything that is going on with SAF, XPO, Blazor, the work that DevExpress is doing, the new features that we are coming up in the last version, the amazing work the community is doing. We always say there is no agenda, but we always have like an official agenda, but the important part is that is driving by you, the community. You guys let us know what you want to talk. I see that some people that are still joining in. Again, there is no formality, no dress code required. A beer or a coffee is highly encouraged. We just take a time in the morning of Thursday or the time frame, the time zone that you are, just to talk about what we love, what we and share our experience regarding SAF, XPO, Blazor, and more. Manuel, he was supposed to be joining us. I think that he might have a personal issue, so we're going to start. Before doing anything else, I know everyone here know Dave and Jose, but I will let them introduce themselves and we go from there.
Dave, you can start if you want.
Sure. Thank you. I'm Dave, MVP, Llama Chant Technology. We do custom development, training, and consulting for all things XAF. Happy to be here. Sorry I've missed the last couple. We've had some overlaps with client requests, so I haven't made the last couple of these, but I do enjoy these, and thanks for having me.
My turn. My name is Jorge Ojeda. I'm also the Express MVP. I work for Build Frameworks and SARI. We do technical consulting. We do custom software, and also we do training for SAF and .NET. And well, I'm here all the time, and you will see me like everywhere. So thanks for having me again.
All right. Your turn. Yeah, absolutely. All right. So the topic of today is really interesting. Is SAF Blazor ready for production? I know that a lot of us are getting crazy because SAF Blazor looks really promising, and it not only looks, it's proving that it is the platform of the future. So again, I always say when the community gets together, great things happen, hackathons, conference, meetups, Zoom meets and more. So I want to encourage everyone to join the community because the community, we might be able to steer the wheel of our needs, ask for new features to DevExpress, do showcase. So one thing that I will definitely love is to hear more experience about what you are doing. If you are using SAF Blazor today, please let's not make only a presentation. Let's make it a conversation. How you are doing? What is still missing for you? What roadblocks have you encountered? And let's try to solve them together. Besides that, I want to, of course, hopefully that you and your family, everyone is safe with all this COVID craziness. Please take care of yourself and your family first of all. And let's pretty much start. Before getting into actually SAF Blazor ready for production, I want to, again, we are in every platform. We are in LinkedIn, we are in Gitter, where we have there all the SAFers interacting, asking questions, giving their experience. Follow DevExpress on Twitter. Right here, you will see the latest announcement. For example, I don't know if you knew that those notifications are coming in 20.2.5. So this is amazing. And one thing that we will show today is like what we were doing meanwhile, because this was not supported until 20.2.5, but we have been using it before in some workarounds. So we'll see all of those today. Join the Facebook group. We are already 836 members and growing. Subscribe to SAFRES weekly. We try to at least once a month, twice a fifth day, sometime weekly, give you the links that of everything that has happened new on SAF, and pretty much join the community. And as I always say, share what you know. There is going to be definitely someone that will benefit from that. And don't be scared to be grown. Grown things get corrected quickly. I have done things that are not completely with best practice in mind. I have had Jose, Manuel, Dave telling me, hey, this is not the way to go. So you learn, you fix it, and you move forward. So that's the most important part here. So if you know something, share your knowledge, do a post, do a YouTube video, and so on. So first thing that I want to, one thing that I forgot to say is like we're part of the .NET virtual user group, and we always have to recommend this one. Please go to that link. There are a lot of events in the .NET space that you will benefit of, and let's move forward. So before we start actually diving in one by one all the topic of SiteBlazer, I will put this question out there if someone wants to answer it. If not, we'll say our own experience. So how many of you are already using SiteBlazer? What are you building with SiteBlazer? What problem have you encountered? If anyone wants, even put it on the chat and we will get to the chat in any question, or even just unmute your microphone and give us your experience. I apologize because I have landscaping right beside me in this moment. So, but please, anyone? Okay, so I will start myself, and let's hopefully that bring some people to share their experience. So, Jose, can you take it for just a second so I can mute until the landscaping people just leave the site?
So, well, guys, the topic of today is that if SiteBlazer is ready for production in general, and basically, well, I have my own opinion, and we were discussing that with Javier yesterday, or maybe a few days ago, and it's like, well, Blazor is not entirely new technology. I mean, it relies on a lot on HTML5 or JavaScript and HTML, so it's something that it was out there from before, like, from way before, so it's easier to jump into it. There is a lot of information. The only thing that might be new somehow are the design patterns. So let's see. Okay, we have something in the chat. Okay, so, well, in general, like, we've been working on SiteBlazer, at least from basically almost day one. And what we did is, like, as we always do, there's a new technology, we jump into it, and then we try to face all the problems that they might come up, basically in the office, but sometimes we do it in real production environments. So basically that's the only way to learn a new technology. You need to go jump into it and face basically all the problems. And we were discussing with Javier, which are the characteristics that you need to move forward with something like Blazor, for example. So the first thing is that if you own a universal license from Developer Express, you will get the source code. First thing, take a look to the source code. You will learn everything that is new there. You will learn the design patterns, and you will know why the stuff are working or not, or what is missing or not. So basically what we did to start was go make a project and basically compile the source code for SiteBlazer. So after that, we say, yeah, it's working. We can use it in production. We also did a load test. So because what's important for us to know how many users we can handle. That was one of the most important requirements. Let's see, we have a lot of things in the chat. One sec. Well, we have someone who is using SiteBlazer for biological science. Anyway, I will continue this, and I guess we will check the chat later. Javier, you're back.
Yeah. Can you guys hear the landscaping?
No.
I told them to move good. A little bit. So, okay. Let's continue then. Okay. SiteBlazer, new front end, new UI for SAF. We have WinForm, WinForms, and there was an attempt to do React, but I think that Blazor is the right choice to move forward because CCChat is what we know. And so where are we right now with SiteBlazer? What is released and what is still missing? Is it ready for production? All of those are questions that we get from the community a lot of time. So let's try to dig a little more in deep on this case. Is SiteBlazer ready for production? I will say yes, but it all depends on your scenario, your requirements, your application. And if you have a good grasp of ASP.NET Core, definitely you will be able to take advantage of everything that Blazor is offering, because Blazor is at the end just a regular ASP.NET Core application. So let's start from here. So if we see this picture here, these are the modules that right now are supported by DevExpress: audit trail, conditional appearance, file attachment, report, validation, and view variants. That's the modules that are so far, and you can even check the roadmap that DevExpress provides. So what modules are we still missing? So the clone module, they don't have it in the wizard yet because it's, they are still doing some tests, but you can definitely go to your application, add it to required modules type, and it's working. We have tested, and so far we have not run into any issue. Maybe there is some special corner case that we don't know about it, so, but at least for our case scenario so far, it's working fine. So dashboards, if you have watched the video that we created, sorry, let me, it's not the video, it's someone on the, let me just mute. Okay, so right here, we have a video, we are showing how to take the dashboard control, the HTML5 and JavaScript control, and integrate it on a Blazor server-side application. And because SAF Blazor is a Blazor server-side, right here, you will have a way to use dashboards in your application. And not only that, you can even change data source and put an XPO data source so it takes your objects that you're using in SAF. So a scheduler, we have another video also integrating the control of the scheduler in SAF Blazor. Maps, Jose did an experiment when he's integrating Google Maps in SAF Blazor. And not only that, the really interesting thing is that he was able to even send an intent with a link so it will open another application like Waze. So you can send the directions and Waze can tell you what to do about it. We have workflow. It's one of the things that are not moving to NetCore. So we need to find another solutions. So right here we have a project that Jose did about using Quartz. And it's a really neat implementation that allows you to, in a separate process, run jobs that you can schedule in different times of the day. Apostolis did another version with Hemfire. So we are showing all the links here, and we're going to show them a little bit of code, but I want to just go over this post really quickly because that will give you an idea that even if it's not everything supported right now, we can definitely integrate ourselves if we know what to look for, where to put everything. And again, one of the best advice that Jose was giving before is the source code. If you go to the source code or the DevExpress Express app dot Blazor, there are a lot of hidden gems there. There is a lot of nice services that you can use with the service provider, get that service and use it yourself in your application. And there is a lot of neat things. The other thing is in this point of time, there are two installers. One that is for SAF Blazor and one that is for SAF WinForms and WinForms. And because of that, we don't have just one solution that is sharing everything, that it has Blazor, WinForms, WinForms. But there is a simple implementation there. Pretty much you just take your agnostic module, convert it to Net Standard, and you add the existing project of module.blazor and blazor.server, and you're good to go. So it's just modified. The only trick thing, and we can see it on the video, is that you have to move to the new CSPro files and delete your assembly.css because you will need to use the package reference that is being used right now in all the projects. So we're going to show the card view today. Custom authentication, DevExpress already provided a really neat example about using custom authentication with Facebook, with Google, with GitHub, with Active Directory. And Jose did a video about how you do that. And you, in that authenticate method, can do anything you want. You can call a web service. You can do your own authentication methods that I wouldn't recommend because SAF security is really powerful. So we also did the example of changing database at runtime. If you decided to support with the same application, different clients with different database, that's also already there. And we have a lot of links about property editors that we will be showing here as well, about a color property editor, a token box property editor, about a color property editor. And I think that is really beautiful. That is just, and we'll show it there. JavaScript interaction, we will show as well that we can have the JS runtime in a controller or any place where the application lives, because pretty much that is injected by dependency injection. So everywhere that you have your application, you can cast to Blazor application and get your JS runtime. We also have identity server, a big project that Manuel did, where you can share your security against different projects. and a few other common tasks like tooltip, touch notification, how to add a button to a detail view, because the approach that we had before about using an action control, that one is not working yet. How to summarize the grid on the list views, because that wasn't still there. How to add a new control. We can talk about localization. We can deploy to Azure, deploy to Linux, deploy to Electron. And that's a really neat thing, because you can have your Blazor application running on Windows, on Mac, on Linux. Jose was talking about the load test that we did. We still are doing more tests about with more concurrent users, and a few experiments about using SAF Blazor as a REST API that Jose showed in a last meetup, in one of the last meetup. So with that one, let's check the chat for a second, because I think that we cover a lot, and then we come back and let's see some code actually. So, okay. Converting. So I see a lot of people in the community that are using SAF, want to migrate, using SAF Blazor, want to migrate from WinForms to Blazor, but I don't see actually no one actually using it in production. I will say that we do have already a few applications running in production, nothing too crazy, but they are being used and they are being used successfully. So,
I think, Javier, there is one point that we need to make, is that what do you need to know in general in order to move to first to Blazor and then to SAF Blazor? Because first, what you need to know is that SAF Blazor is not different than SAF. It's the same design pattern. You will have business object, you will have view controllers. Usually what people is waiting right now is the modules, because people depend on the modules, right? So. But if you want to do only the CRUD at the beginning, it's just the same code. You don't have to change anything, basically. Just change your connection string or something like that. And beside that, you can start. But also, I think there is a good opportunity, because we got this question somehow, like quite often. It's like, what do I need to know to move to Blazor in general, right? Because you need to know the platform specific. And also, there is another thing that Denny said, like, I don't know, like 3 meetings ago or something like that, is like, you need to follow the platform. Each platform have their own design patterns. So you need to do what is best for that, because you can migrate it, like just copy the code from web forms or from Windows forms or diagnostic code and try to run it, and it will work somehow. But the main idea is to know the design patterns and to get advantages, because before, Microsoft didn't give you any design pattern. Everything was like a general purpose language. For example, right now, NetCore in general and Net5, the use of dependency injection is quite common. Before, it was not common at all. You have to decide to do it or not. So right now, it comes into the pattern for the applications. So that's what you need to know to start with Blazor. Basically, is ASP.NET Core. HTML5, which will be JavaScript and HTML. You need to know the structure of the DOM. And basically, besides that, microservices, I would say, and maybe dependency injection. I don't know if I covered like everything that we decide to that was necessary, but you can put any other point, Javier, if you want.
Yeah, no, the only thing that I would say, I saw that there was a question of Jan Paul on the chat about using domain component in SAF Blazor, and you can read this whole ticket, and it's really interesting, and it's really large. But the end points, I will say, is like, you will miss, it's doable, but you will miss support from DevExpress. You are on your own there, because they are not supporting domain component on SAF Blazor. So if you are comfortable enough with figuring out things yourself, and if you run into roadblock, get into the source code and even recompile it if you need, by all means, good to go. But if you rely on DevExpress support, as we always do, I will take a little bit of warning there to avoid like future issues. So with here, we have a lot of links here. I'm pretty sure that we cannot cover them all, but please, I will start with a few, but in the chat, please let us know what the things that you would like to see the most. Because, for example, I have seen Safers asking me, hey, is it ready for production? I say, yes, it depends on your requirement. And he say, yeah, but for example, the lookups, I don't have a new button to create a new one. Or the lookups are too slow, or because they have to load all the records from the data source, or we don't have tooltips, or there is no dashboard, or there is no scheduler, or there is missing things still. So I'm going to start, for example, with the, yeah, please. Wagen.
Hi, everybody. My name is Behardin. Today, just I want to ask a favor or a question. Can we add to our discussion the part of mobile apps? You know that since version 19, DevExpress has focused on developing the Blazor and the abandoned mobile app part in XAF, and they moved it even from their wizard. So the argue here was that they will focus on Blazor, and Blazor will substitute the mobile app application. But till now, for myself, I have no clue about how they will migrate or how they will substitute the previous part of mobile implementation inside there. And still, this area is still vague. It's still not clear. Can we discuss about it?
Hey, Dave, you want to take that one?
Yeah, that's actually something that I've been thinking about too. I was one who actually skipped the mobile development altogether. It just didn't fit our model. So we stuck with Xamarin Forms as needed, and actually Jose took care of all those for us. What we did find with Blazor, we haven't proved it out in the XAF side of things yet, but you can do the progressive web applications where you visit the website and it says, hey, do you want to install directly on your mobile? And when you click that, then you get that little shortcut link. And it behaves as if it is a mobile application on the device, but obviously it is web-enabled at that point. So that's something I'm looking forward to putting some time into to see if we can make that work, because I think that does solve, in our case, it solves a lot of the need for mobile development if we can get that progressive web app happening.
How was it?
Yeah, now it's my turn. Basically, like, well, Javier knows me, like, I always try to do, like, really crazy stuff. So I was thinking, like, okay, let's try to compile, let's take the source from Blazor, actually, and try to recompile it for Xamarin, so we can host it inside Xamarin, because we were doing some experiments with Electron. And we did some progress in that sense. But then like we stopped because it was just an experiment. I guess I will work on that because a lot of people asked for it and publish what I have. There are several ways to use SAF somehow as your backend application. Maybe you will not be able to use, like, to generate all the application like SAF does, but you can use a lot from it. Basically, right now you have like the web API for XPO. There is a way to use a security system with Xamarin. So there are many ways. Maybe it will not be the complete SAF application, but there are ways to use the most, so you can have like a congruent application between your web application, your desktop application, and your mobile application. But maybe, Javier, what are your thoughts about it?
So let me ask you this, Barhadin, and hopefully I'm pronouncing that right.
Yes, you're doing it correct. You pronounce it very well, Jose. I don't know, Javier, it's Javier or Javier or what? How do you pronounce it?
Javier.
Javier.
Javier. So I ask you also, not because of that. In the last meetup, we have a feedback from a software that it was saying that I should slow down a little bit because my accent was too sick for some people. So again, we want to improve this, and we want to make this a place that we can learn and we can make as much quality content as possible. So if any of us are speaking fast, if with anything, I'm more than happy to get that feedback and slow down. So if anyone is not understanding anything, please ask us again. I'm more than happy to repeat. So, but my question to you, Barhadin, is you're saying that you went the SAF mobile route, that you already have a SAF mobile application and you're trying to do a migration to the Blazor one, or just because, again, the Blazor one will be definitely the replacement for the mobile part. So if we here just select...
Actually, let me answer this. For mobile app, I tried before to have a small app or a production application for the old ZEF mobile application. It was in PhoneGap platform. And really, it was a nightmare for me to maintain and to take care about the improvement and all that stuff, the development. But what I was hoped for is to have a solid implementation for mobile application, because this is one of the now demanding in the market, especially in the UAE market or in Middle East in general. So the roadmap for mobile application is still not clear in XAF. At the beginning, we thought that they will replace somehow the XAF mobile with a new technology, including either Xamarin or Blazor. But I'm seeing that this is not happening. So I want to know, when can we see a good progress in this matter?
Okay, I will tell you my opinion. It's not any official answer or anything, but they are right now pushing to a web mobile version. So a version of SAF that is optimized to be responsive in different resolutions. And this is the case that they were seeing with Blazor. They are not planning in any shape or form any native implementation that you will be like submitting. Again, we need to wait for WebAssembly and things, and like Dave was saying, a progressive web app and things like that. But right now, they are not going that route. I'm still a little excited about this because I personally have tested the mobile Blazor binding. That is an experiment project, but you take the same design patterns, the same way that you are doing your UI in Blazor, and you compile it with Xamarin. So it sits on top of the Xamarin stack, and it does compile to native. So when that project gets to a more stable release, I think that we will be able to, the components that we are using here in SAF, put it in a Xamarin project, compile it to the Apple Store, and we have a native application. So all is still really new. All is still just in actually, they have the experimental flag right there. If we look for Blazor mobile bindings, you will see that the first thing that they put is experimental. It's like just use it at your own risk. But I actually talked with a guy who did that conference, presentation, and he says, what is ready for production for you? That's depend, like he had applications already on the App Store using this, but it's just simple application. It's still nothing crazy. It's not being tested with a really big enterprise or anything. But maybe for your a scenario, it works. And the nice thing is, like with Blazor, you can pack all those components in a NuGet packet and reuse it in another project and connect to the same database. You can do crazy things. So the future is promising, but I can tell you right now that SAF right now is not pointing to any native part. It's going to the web mobile responsive. And actually, if you see, this is a link that Dennis sent me that he wants me to show here on the community stand-up. And it's like the SAF Blazor UI is optimized for desktop and mobile web browser. That's the solution for using it in mobile right now. And I have to say, we have applications running in production right now. Looks nice on iPhone, on phones, and not only that, they are fast. It's not like, I don't know if you have tested the SAF mobile. I did. It was crazy. And it was not user-friendly, in my opinion. The interaction was like, to see a collection, you have another button. When you click that button, it goes to the other list view that it looks.
Yeah, I passed through all these nightmares. As I told you, it was a nightmare.
And it was taking a long time just to load just a few 100 records. It was crazy slow. So I'm really excited about this implementation because Blazor is really efficient in the way that he's sending the HTML back and forward. He has a copy of your DOM in memory, and when you do a change, he compare and only send you the diff. It will only change you. If you only change a bold in a text, it only tell you that style on the CSS. So it's really, really efficient. So I would say that that's the way to go.
I'd like just to give you my experience in this with a true cases. I had an application, the time attendance sheet that was written in version 18, that version 18 before the mobile app. I tried to do some experimental development on the mobile at that time. And when I upgraded to 19 and 20, I had to abandon all implementation or all this experimental in mobile app, and I went toward the Xamarin in such case that I can use the Xamarin as a front end and the XPO as a back end, so that I can connect to the same environment as XAF. And this was very successful, but it is not as if this was integrated but out of the box. And that's why I'm looking forward to have something like that helped me in my production production application. As I understand from you now that this will be a long way to achieve. So I have to keep with what I have, and I'll try to deployment. And I wish if we can, as a community, try to do something like that together. So I think this will be a good add to XAF in general.
I would say that you just described my exact experience. I tried SAF mobile. I did the whole development. It was not that bad. I deployed to PhoneGap. Then I realized it was too slow, that the clients didn't like the look and feel, how the user experience, the collection, how it was showing and everything else. And I have to move to Xamarin. And then we moved completely to Xamarin. And in Xamarin, we did really good. The difference is, like Xamarin, when you are used to SAF, you get spoiled. Everything is working. Everything is as it should. When you come back to Xamarin, everything breaks. Sometimes you spend a whole day because your studio didn't. So there are, it's a different animal. So, yes. But it is what it is. So let me just, for a second, run one project, because when you were talking about that, I remember that I have something that I wanted to show. And let's go to the one of the issues that we had with SAF Laser Soil right now. And let's look at the FAQ. And this FAQ, I recommend everyone to read it now and then, because they are actually, they have everything that is being updated almost every week with new things that are coming up, with everything that is being developed. But I want to ask, before anything else, one of the things, performance. One of the things that I would say that you really need to address is the lookups, because right now, if you see here, they load all records from the data source when DataView is displayed. And not only that, you don't have a way to, and maybe we can even see it here. Let me just close the, let's see if we have a lookup here. Maybe not. I should have. Let's see, this one should have a lookup assigned to. Let me move here. So if you see, there is not a way to create a new one. If you want to create a new one, you have to go to your contacts, create a new one there, then to show it here. So that's definitely is a stopper for some places because it's not intuitive. But if you check their the same ticket that they were explaining there, you will see that there is a new. And let's look up property editor that is right there. So if you put that, this search lookup property editor, and you put, of course, that is true. So every time that there is a lookup, it will use this property editor instead of the property editor that comes by default. And let's run it for a second. And I think that I'm running something else. Wait, let me take this one from here. Mm-hmm. Let's wait for it. This is one of the issues that when I have talked with SAFER, they have complained the most. Like, my lookups doesn't have a new. My lookups take a long time to load everything. My memory goes up a lot. And I think that, if I'm not mistaken, Andres is here on the chat, and he is one of the staffers who complained to me about that with every reason. But I'm pretty sure that DevExpress will address this in the near future. But meanwhile, what can we do? We can use that workaround and use that new local property editor. One thing that I want to show here, and let's show it real quick. When you log in, there is an exception that is getting thrown up, and you have this application error quickly, but it doesn't do anything. It comes back and restore. If you target your project, your server project, to Net 5 instead of Net Core 3, that will get fixed. That won't happen anymore, and that will just log in without any exception. The only issue is that for development, I will leave it in 3.1, because if you put it in Net 5, the model, it doesn't work anymore. So if you have to do something on the model, then the application, you have to put it back to 3.1. So pretty much what we're doing, we use 3.1 in all the development phase, and before we do a deploy, we change it to Net 5, and it works perfectly. So that search up lookup editor, now if we go to, for example, to invoice, and if you see here, we have, I think that 1,000 customers, and we'll see about this, how we added this grid summary and count here. But if we go to invoice, we can click new, and then we have this that is a lookup property editor. And then we can click search, and we have everything there is loading by demand, the memory is going down. You can create a new customer if you need to, and you can move forward. There is nothing. You can even say, when I click new here, just show me the detail view. You don't have to, for example, show the collection or anything. Just show me this part. And it's a beauty. It's something that when you click on it, select it, and you're good to go. So that's coming from this search up lookup property editor. That you can take a look of how everything is done, but meanwhile, the lookup property editor is not official release. This is a workaround that you can use, that it will have loading data on demand. It will have a new action. It will have everything you need, so you can give value to your customers right away, because that's the important part. And yeah, I was right. Andres is here on the chat, and he's actually putting his experience there, so you guys can also take a look. And please, if anyone else have, again, another roadblock, showstop, anything that they want us to cover here, the code for that lookup property editor, if you go to the, and that's what I'm saying, please now really often check this FAQ from DevExpress for the SAF Blazor. If you go to the last section, that is non-issues, you will see that one of the issues that lookup property, lookup editors load all the data source when the data view is displayed, and it doesn't have a new button. So if you click that ticket, you will see the workaround right there with the code that you need to put. So try here, and you can just copy this code, put it on your application, and that's it. Pretty much this post about all type of workarounds, support center tickets, work for the community. All of those are or work that we have done ourselves or another community or support ticket center. All of these are, let's say, while we wait for the official release, that is the one that we should use, because that one will be supported. That one is done with the best practices. That one is the way to go. You have this workaround meanwhile to do everything else. And for example, I will run this one first, and then I will go to the chat to see what people else want to see. But let me just comment this out for a second. And uncomment this out. And if I'm not mistaken, let me see. Okay. Ah, this is another project. Okay, perfect. So let me run this one first, so I can show you what we're doing here. So pretty much this was a proof of concept about, let's see how we can do a list editor, a card view. And if you see here, while that's loading, we did a table list editor that is inheriting from the grid list editor. So we're using all the functionality from the grid list editor. We are just replacing the UI. And let's wait for it so you can see what I'm talking. So Jose, correct me if I'm wrong. There is a question on the chat about exporting from the grid to Excel. That's not there out of the box, but there is a view controller that you can export everything to Excel.
Yeah, basically in that case, it's like, well, a lot of people approach us to do Excel import and export. There are many ways to do that. Basically, I mean, even if the control doesn't have it right now, like the grid from Developer Express, you can basically take the data source and do it yourself. I think like you can basically use the API that they have, like the Excel API, and export it. And also there is another nice framework that we use is OpenXML. If you want to work with Excel, and want to have full control on how you create your files, you can take a link to this.
Are you showing something, Jose, or
no? No. I'm going to put the link on the chat.
Got it.
Because like, if you want to have full control of how it's exporting, go that and use OpenXML. We use it a lot. That's basically the format that the Excel, all the Office file use is basically a zip with an XML inside. At the beginning, it's a little bit strange on how to work with, but you will get used to, and you have like full control. You can basically do whatever you do in Excel, you can do in that format. The only thing that you cannot do is to execute the formulas, because that is only a definition. But beside that, if you want to read or write to Excel file or to a Word document or to a PowerPoint, that's the way to go.
Okay, so let's continue with the CarView. And Fernando, if that answered your question, just let us know so we are sure that we cover your question. If not, just let us know and we come back to it. So if you see here, let's quickly discuss this project. We have the table list editor that is inheriting from the grid list editor. It will be for the type domain object one, and it has a create control core method that we're overriding, and we are creating the render fragment from the CarView razor that we have here. If you see here, the CarView has pretty much H3 CarView and a table that is doing a for each for every item in the data source and creating a new row. That's it. And then we click the row and we just open the data view. But we can just click here and it'll open the data view. So now the issue that I want to show here is like the car razor view. It's just HTML, so we can put any HTML that we want here. If we have a really good front-end designer, the limitation is your imagination here. So I will walk quickly through the implementation, and then we'll put another car view to see this work. Pretty much, again, table list editor inheriting from a grid list editor. And I want to say this is 20.2.3, and 20.2.4, the only thing that we have to do different is like we have to grab the render fragment in a component holder because there was some refactoring there, but that's the price to pay to be working on the bleeding edge of everything, working on the previous, that things will change. But it will be the same implementation, just adding a component holder in the mix. But if you see here, we have here our components project, that is where our CarView resides, and this is a Razor library as everything else. And then you can have here your CSS, your JavaScript, everything you need. And because we could not reference directly that component to the module agnostic, because then we'll have to reference to the Blazor and will be like a circular reference, we created my contracts that pretty much it has an interface that will define. Because again, when you're doing, for example, a car view, you don't need to show every property that object have. You only may need the picture, the country, the name, so for a trip. So you do an interface that will be the contract of what you will be showing in that interface. With that one, we put our HTML together that inherit from that domain iDomain object. And if you check domain object, of course, have to implement that iDomain object, and you're good to go. So for example, and I, in the video, I did this at the moment, but let's do it here. If I do here HTML car view bootstrap, because the projects that we're using in SAS Blazor use bootstrap, and we go here, we can select any of this one. Let's any of this one. The one that I select, I think that it was this one. I select this code. I went to our project. I pasted here. It's actually this one. And then I did exactly the same as we did on top. Let's comment this out. Oh, let me see. Okay, I'm running the application. That's why it's... And I have to say, sometimes because Blazor is new, I think the tool in the Visual Studio hasn't catch up to it. So sometimes IntelliSense is not working. Sometimes it's giving an error when there is not an error. Sometimes it's just delete your bin folder, restart Visual Studio, and go back again. And that's exactly how it was in Xamarin, or how it is still. That sometimes it's like everything is right, and you lose 2 hours trying to figure it out why it's not working. It is, again, the price to pay if you are working on the bleeding edge. So if you see here, again, I'm just going through the data source, doing a for each, and creating the car view. And I'm passing here the name, the country, and then I'm doing concatenating the name plus the country, and I leave this, and we can even put here Meetup, and here SAF Community Rocks. And if we run it again, you will see that the UI that you will be displaying is only constrained by your imagination. If you have a really good HTML5 CSS person, you will do wonders. Let's wait for it just a second. Right there, you have, there is a different car view right there. So it's just choose your HTML, anything you want, put it there, it will be to go. We can do something like, and I was opening this project to do that, but I was trying to find what was the path.
I'd like to point out to Jose, you've put this into a separate library, because this actually takes me back to 2008 when XCF was first released. We didn't have a lot of the stuff we take for granted today. So we were, you know, developing things like putting user model files into the database. So we developed a piece, you could distribute the model files, you could edit the model files, you could reset your model files, and then, you know, a couple years later, it became out of the box in XAF. So keeping those separate in a separate project will certainly help you manage that as the Blazor XAF matures.
And also think about this, Dave. Let's say that the mobile Blazor binding project about compiling with Xamarin and everything gets stable, gets good enough for us to use it. We can reuse this library that is already done. We just have to reference this library in our Xamarin project, and we will be able to use this component. So yeah, it's a win-win. So regarding a mobile part, let me show you. This is another car view, for example, that let's say that if we put the HTML here, it will populate that. But if you change the resolution, you see how beautiful, like, again, desktop resolution. So this is a really great example of how we can optimize our application for mobile resolutions. So again, here the constraint is what can you imagine? Like in this case, we always had this myth that we already did a meetup on that SAF UI is not customizable. Hey, I can assure you, it's customizable with form and web form, and we have a lot of screenshot to show it. But right now with Blazor, you can do everything. You can do anything you have in there, and not only that, you can do all of those and have your security, your validation, your conditional appearance. A lot of great things that SAF already provide for us. So I haven't seen anyone ask for anything that they have encountered in Blazor, so we will continue with any other.
Javier, project. I want to do a question for the community. Maybe you can help us out in the chat. Basically, what I would like to know is like, which is the module that is avoiding you to move to Blazor? Which is the one that you need for your application? If you can pick one or two that you consider the most important. So in the end, that's useful for us because we will do experiments with that, with those ideas. Like, hey, you can move forward like doing this, doing that, and so on and so forth, right? So for me, what will be interesting is like, which is the part of your current staff web forms or your staff Windows Forms application that you think that you cannot move to Blazor, or that is in like, or is like this foundation of your application. So if you can help us out with that in the chat, it will be amazing for the next weeks so we can work on it. I mean, take a look, make more articles and try to help you out with that.
And not only that, I will say not only modules, features in general. What do you are still missing? Do you like, for example, do you need to change database at runtime? Do you need to authenticate with GitHub, with Google, with Facebook, with anything? Any feature, just let us know.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing with the new action on the lookups. And for me in particular, it was the action container view items to put actions onto a detail view. I had to write my own custom one for that last week. So,
and actually, let me see if let me just look for it. But I'm looking for not the official document, this one. Again, we always say that reading the source code, looking for the documentation always are great. And I had the same issue that they were saying. I tried to add an action to the detail view as we always do with an action control container. I don't know if I'm saying that right. And it didn't work. Then I got into the ticket that it was actually showing how to do it, but in a different way. That's not the way that we're doing in Blazor because that's still not supported. So it sent me to this article of how to add the button to a detail view using a custom view item. But, and I will ask your opinions here. You need to go to Net Standard 2 to see the Blazor implementation right here. And the problem that I have with this is that I feel that some people get here and they don't find it and say, no, it's not supported. And they don't know about this selector. I don't know what do you guys don't think that it would be better to have just one page that you can scroll down and it has and maybe another title that say Net Standard 2 or Blazor Part. That way it's everything in just one page and it's not confusing, but maybe it's just me. Either way, I want to show that implementation. If we go to our project and we go and let's see the model.blazor and let's see we have right here. We're creating a view item that it will be button detail view item. And we're going to do again, this is the part that I was talking about. We're going to do a component holder that component holder will take our custom Razor control and create it and put it in our detail view. So with that one, if you see our button dot and Razor, pretty much right here, we have a DX button. That's it. With a click me. And that just called the JS runtime that we're injecting here and say action is executed in alert. And then with that one, sorry, we can go to the model. Let's see.
Well, does this respond to the active and enabled properties as well?
No. Okay. Because this is actually again, this is a custom component that we're adding as in a view item. The only issue is that we're using a DX button here. But right here, we could have put a calendar view. We can put anything there, and we could show it in that detail view if we want. But it's not directly attached to the business object that you're showing. So right here, you most probably will have to do, I don't know, some value manager or something and get the object that you want and do something with it. Or we can look at that implementation later on, but pretty much right here, what he's doing is button click, yes, runtime, and showing alert, just to prove that we can put a button there. And using the inheriting from view item, and in the component holder, we're saying our button that is our Razor component, create, and that will give us the render fragment. And if we run it, you will see that we have a button in that list view that will show an alert. But again, that alert is completely disconnected from the business object. So we need to pass also a reference to what business object is and use maybe an object space, get the object and do some processing with it. But let's see it for just a second.
Also, Javier, another thing that it can be done there is like, you can make it as a property editor because the property editor, they expose the interface that use the conditional appearance. So you can enable it, disable it, change color, change like whatever you can do with the conditional appearance. So, but again, that will be a hack. So we can wait for the official implementation. But what everyone is asking all the time about Blazor is like, is it ready? It's as ready as much as you know how to handle the pattern, I guess.
Jose, it's so funny to look at you and see you with a pirate thing. But anyway, let's continue. Again, if we now open the detail view, we have a DX button here. So right here, we could have put any control. If you click, it does what we are showing here. It does the alert, action is executed, and you have a button in the detail view. So again, most of the things that they are still not supported, there is a workaround that we can get it there. Same thing I was talking about property editor, and now that I have this detail view open, this is a really nice property editor. If you need to put some type of color in your application, you have here, you can select, you can move it. You can actually put the values that you want. And even if you, the hexadecimal code and everything. And this color property editor, let's look for it just a second. Color property editor. Right here, it will be for every property of type of color, and we put a default to everything. And pretty much what it's doing is the same thing. It goes to the color picker adapter, it goes, like again, in Blazor right now, there are three concepts. It's like the render fragment that is a grab to a component holder, and then you have an adapter and the model. And right here, we are using our own adapter and our own model. And we have our component that at the end, this is what matters. This is what is going to give you that a really beautiful implementation. But again, this is another of the tickets that is on the DevExpress documentation. So let me see if we have it. SAF, Blazor, edit color, most probably, we should show. Right here. This is, and that's what I always recommend reading the support center, because there are so many beautiful things here. So pretty much I saw this ticket, I said, oh, this is really nice. I went there, I copied the component, I copied the color property editor, put it on my project, tested, good to go. No, it's not private, Fernando. This is visible for every user. So it's not even my ticket. I just saw it so that it was really nice. I say, what I say, I want to show the community that, again, Jose already asked for what modules are you missing and asking what features are you missing. But pretty much we're trying to, and that's why this post is called While We're Waiting for a Feature Release. What we can do meanwhile, and there are a lot of things that we can do and we are showing. Other things that we have here, and let me see. Yeah, you see, if I hover over, there is my tooltip demo. That's another ticket that we found that there is three ways of creating those. And let's show that quickly. Tooltips, right here. This is another ticket. There are three ways because tooltips are still not supported. So you can do null text. That means that, for example, in this, if I delete everything, enter your name, you will give the user some type of indication, hey, put your name. You can do some type of validation, but with the information result type. You know that in validation, we have error, warning, and information. So information will not prevent you for saving or for nothing. This is just so you know. So this one, if you put validation to this one and you hover over tooltip sample. But I like this one more because this one, give you a nice way, that you can definitely have to go to the model. And hopefully I have it open. And let's stop for a second so we can see it. And use the same tooltip property on the model. Leave here. Let's see. Okay, now, like every demo that it need at some point to fail for a little bit, let's clean it and run it again to open the, let's close it. So again, while that, this is doing the same thing, what modules are you still missing? What feature are you still missing? Let us know. So maybe we already have a solution. Maybe we can work together as a community. Maybe we can put a ticket. Okay, let's try to open the model. What did we change? Nothing. Let me just... Okay, let's do something then. Let's open folder in File Explorer. We have a really nice bat that clean all the bins, all the object folders and so on. So I will just right away copy this, go back to my solution. Put it there, run my bat. That will delete all my bins, all my object, everything that I don't need, and let's rebuild. Hopefully that fixes it. If not, we continue. Jose, are you watching the chat in case that we have questions here? Because
I've been chasing it down.
Both of us.
Yeah.
Okay. It happens. Sometimes it just doesn't want to work and we don't have the time to keep doing, but pretty much what that implementation does is that you can use the actual note on the model that it says tooltip, put your tooltip text there, and that will show, as we show in the, as we saw that when you hover over, it shows on top. So that's another implementation that we have. We also, again, three choices, null text, validation rules, and set the editor's HTML in code. So if you see here, they pretty much are adding the attribute and it will see be tooltip as here. And then just a simple CSS that when you hover, it shows that value. We're good to go. So the possibilities that we have right now with SAS Blazor are crazy amazing and crazy happy. And one of the other things, if you know the show view strategy, show message, it was not supported and it will be supported in 20.2.5. But we even have a workaround now. So if we run the application again, one that we have used forever, and I'm pretty sure that everyone, how about that? I'm pretty sure that everyone here has used it at some point, that is when you want to show a message in an agnostic way, what do you do? Like for Windows.
User friendly exception.
Yes.
So true.
So, and not only that, sometimes I have even used a non-persistent class that is just a message class with the text that is going to be, and I open the detail view of that message class, and that way I show the message that I want. Yeah, and restarting BS, it was time. So, that's a really agnostic solution. The show message one, it wasn't working and it's going to be working, but so far you can do a throw new user friendly section and you can do a show a message with a non-persistent class. So let's see if we can run this and I'll show you both. Important that I want you to have in consideration is if we go to the host, And I don't think this was in 20.2, in 20.2.3. This is just in 20.2.4. They add this component here in the host. That is component of alert handler. So if you try 20.1 and 20.2.3 before 20.2.4, if you throw a new user-friendly section, the application was going to crash. It won't allow you. But right now, if you add this component here, the alert handler, it does give you a really nice toast message. And I think that this time it will run. So it's coming. I agree completely with the Dave's suggestion on the chat. And another thing that I want to talk about, because we have been asking, what are you guys missing? Nobody has said localization. And that's one thing that we're still missing. But we
also,
do have...
Is anyone using right to left on Blazor's application? Well, that's part of localization, I guess.
Yeah, I don't think that's yet there. But, okay, if you see here, we have show message that this controller, and let's show the code for just a second. Let's see to the Blazor. User-friendly section. If you see here, we have two actions, so show message and show detail view. The show message one pretty much is just throwing a new user-friendly section. The second one is creating a detail view, putting a model window and opening that detail view. That's it. And that message parameter class is just a non-persistent class with just one property, message. So what we're doing in the here is just passing the message, SAF Blazor Rock. So if we see here, this is, will be the throw user friendly section. Nice. You have a really nice toast here that lets you know. And if you show the other one, SAF Blazor definitely rocks. And of course, you can change in the detail view the title, or you can change anything, but that is a way. And right here, you can do OK, cancel, and you can react depending on if they click OK, that do an action. If they click cancel, do nothing. So we have that capability here. And in 20.2.5, will come already that you can use show view strategy, show message, pass the message option, and you're good to go. So that's another...
Also, Javier, there is another hack. I don't know if you remember that we did that experiment, but it requires reflection that these people is not used to go through that path. But do you remember that there was one case that we have like services, they come from Developer Express actually, it's like the message service or something like that. It's private. But if you use it by reflection, you can actually execute it like whenever you want. But I don't know where we have that source. I guess what's in that solution, like Blazor 16 or something like that. But I guess we need to make a video about it.
Yeah. So another thing that is really interesting is for some reason, if we do a quick search again and we say SAF full text filter, full text search action. Let me see if right here. If you see here in Windows, in web, and even in mobile, we have this the search with an X to clear the search right on top. That is still not there in SAF Blazor. So if I click here, then there is nothing to clear the filter. So if I put here Jose, I search, it shows there. But if I want to clear this search, I have to delete and click here again. It's not a big deal in my opinion, but incredible as it seems, we had a client that it was really important for him. He said, this is not a good experience. He needs to clear the filter right or something. So this is what we did. We go to the clear filter controller. And there are a couple of things that I want to point out here. This is just a simple action, nothing crazy. And the simple action, take the controller and take that full text filter action, put the value to null and do a search with null. That means that it will bring everything. But let me show you something else. After you was doing that search and we were doing clear filter, the filter was executed correctly, but this Jose was still there. It didn't refresh that part. So what did we do to fix that? So if you see here, this is a way to get the IGS runtime on your controller. You have your application, that you can cast it to your Blazor application and use the service provider that the application have. And with that service provider, you can call any of those really nice services. And if you go to the DevExpress, Express App Blazor, there are a lot of really nice services there that you can use. You call the JS runtime, and then you invoke the function that you need in your JavaScript. But to be able to find this set focus function, of course, the function have to be here. You need to have a script, JavaScript, that does the function. If you see, pretty much it's getting the selector, finding the element, putting the value to null, and doing focus. That's it. But you need to go to your host and let them know where is that script. With that one, he will be able to find where is the JavaScript that I need to execute. So if I do now, again, Jose, I search, and then I do clear filter. It clears the filter, it does the search, get focus here for in case you want to do another filter. So this is the, and I am not a JavaScript guy. Definitely, I try to use as less JavaScript as possible. But if you need to use it, if it's a library that has been stable for so many years, this is a really great, great way to interact with JavaScript right away, really fast and beautiful. And I don't know you guys, but for me with Net 5, there are two things that I'm in love with. One is CSS isolation, that means that we will have all components that it will have CSS that only apply to that component, and a JavaScript isolation, that it means that we only load the JavaScript when we need it. We don't have to reference anymore in the host. How about that? Okay, so Jose, I'm gonna switch a little bit to you, and then we can come back with a few more examples. Do you wanna show anything about how to access a property editor that is already there on SAF, how to inherit from them, or how to modify any of their settings so they can see that, and then we come back to my side? I definitely like the Dave idea of going back and using SAF version 8 or 9 and see how much we have improved. And Jose, you are in mute.
Okay, so can anyone see my screen? I guess I'm sharing already. Okay, so let me close this. We were working on how to change the settings for the editors. And basically we were reviewing this idea and we decided to create a video for it. I mean, there is a video already on YouTube showing this, but it's like, sometimes you don't need to create your own editor. Sometimes you can just change some settings. For example, the example that they put there is that they want to change the calendar from the normal calendar to show the scroll calendar. So there are several ways to do this, but in general, what you need to do is try to follow the design pattern of the platform. So in this case of Blazor. So what I did here is like I have a normal SAF Blazor application. There is basically, let's go to the module. So in the business object, there is only like one object. And in here I have two datetimes, this one and this one. This one is using, basically it's using a custom property editor, and this is being customized. So let me show you what I did here. So I came to the Blazor module and I went to the controller section. So here we have something new that is an extension, and actually I really don't know if this extension exists for all the other platforms. So let's check this. So let's go here to definitions. And let's wait. Okay, so this is, well, this extension is basically, well, it's for the standard, but it will work, I guess, for any platform anyway. I was thinking this was a Blazor thing, but no. So the thing that you can do is like on the activated method, well, this is a method, but you can also wire the event. You tell the view that you want to customize a view item control, and you tell it which type of view item you need to customize. In this case, we're using a datetime property editor, but since it's a view item, basically you can customize anything that you're putting as a view item. Maybe it can be an action also, for example, because actions have, they are in an action holder, if I remember well. So you can, I think you can also do this code for customize it. So basically the idea is that when the view is ready, you need to tell which property of the view you want to modify and which method you want to execute. So in that method, you will get a reference for that property editor. So in here, what we're doing is like, okay, we are getting the control of the property editor. And in this case, we have to do this in the StaffBlazor module because we're getting an adapter. If you go and check the design pattern of Blazor, basically they have like a model view model for each component. So they have a contract with, they send the data, then also they have the adapter and so on and so forth. I mean, we can explain that maybe in another video one time. So once you get the adapter, you have the component model. The component model will be exactly like if you're using Xamarin Forms or you have used Xamarin Forms before, you know that every view have a view model. In this case, you have the same, that what is called component model. So it's exposing the properties that will communicate with the controller and with the data. So with this, we can say like, okay, go and let's do the picker display mode and we put it in scroll picker. So let me run this. This, we will run it for the property day of birth of the customer class. So let's go here. We're going to run it for this one. And also we have created on. So the modifications that we did will only affect this one, not this one. So let's run this.
Hey Dave, I really like your idea of installing SAF 8 or 9 and see the difference. That would be amazing.
I think it'd be kind of fun. Go all the way back.
Yeah, I not long ago, I was listening to a podcast of Oliver and Storm when SAF was going to be CTP for the first time in 2007. It was a really nice, interesting project because right there, it was just what we want to achieve. So it was really nice.
We were writing our own framework at the time before XDF came out. And then basically, with 6 months worth of work we'd done, XDF came out. I stayed through the night. Basically, everyone went home at 5 o'clock. I stayed through the night and actually reproduced everything we did in that 6 months in one night.
Nice. Crazy.
Okay, guys, so this is loading. Let's wait a little bit. I don't know if we'll create the database. I don't know if I deleted it before. So let's see.
I honestly believe that more people don't use SAF because they don't know it. That as soon as they start getting into it, getting to know how the framework goes, getting to have more knowledge, they never go back. It's just to get to that point that they don't get discouraged in the middle on that learning curve. If they pass that one, they won't ever go back.
Also, I think, Javier, that if you ever use SAF, you don't want to use Xamarin then. Because it's the opposite. SAF is hyper-functional and everything just works. I mean, at least in the mature platforms like Windows Forms and Web Forms. But if you go to Xamarin, it's always like an adventure. You don't know if it's going to work just because the computer didn't want to work, for example. But I guess the tooling will be getting better like for Next 6 and Next 5. But okay, let's go back to the example. So in here we have date of birth. And in this case, it should show, see, is a different calendar. And in this other one, it's showing the normal calendar. So this is a neat way to change the behavior of a property editor if you don't want to write your own property editor. But there is another way. You can also, let's see, get your own editor and inherit them from their editor. So in this case, I'm doing almost the same. But instead of writing a controller, I'm creating my own property editor. So I'm inheriting from the data in property editor. And in here, you know that if you have ever created your property editor, your own property editor, you need to basically create a control and return it and then do the binding, right, with the data. But since we're using theirs, So we don't need to do all the plumbing. Everything is done, like the wiring of all the vents and so on and so forth. So basically here, we just need to get the control when the control is created and change whatever we want to change. So in this case, I'm doing this like, okay, if the control is a DX date read adapter for nullable daytime, I will do something. And also I can do something else if the type is different. And you need to be careful with this because I was working on this like 2 days or 3 days ago. And I was creating my own property editor. And the adapters are specialized for the data type. So daytime and nullable daytime is not exactly the same. You can do, if you try to cast to daytime, for example, it will break. So just a recommendation. I was thinking like, what is happening? The code looks fine, but no. I mean, you always have to change if your properties are nullable and do the correct casting for it. Okay, so in this case, what we're going to do is we have our own custom property editor. And then I follow Javier's advice to learn how to use the model because I never use it. I always go to the code solution. But after I create my own property editor, what I did is like I came to the view and I selected which property editor to use. So here in the items, I have the created on. And in the picker, after I create the property editor, I have it available basically. So I selected this and I did a little bit of modification in my business object. This business object should format the daytime to display the time part, because otherwise it will only show the date. So let's run this again. And let me show you the second property editor, which is an inheritance of their property editor of Developer Express official editor. So.
Hey, Jose, do you have a question on the chat? Jan Paul is asking, can we use attributes on properties for the editor type?
Hold on, can you repeat that?
Can we use attributes on properties for the editor type? I'm honestly not following the question either. So, Jean Paul, if you want to clarify a little bit, or maybe you got it.
I think I got it, but it would be better if we have like a little bit more explanation. But I will.
After you finish, just read the chat and come back to us.
Yeah. So, okay. In this case, as you can see, here we have the calendar. But in here we have the calendar, but the date and time, is displayed. So there are several ways to customize it. It will depend on if you want to do like a really huge customization, maybe it's better to have a property editor. And if not, you can just do it in a controller. If you're going to only do it once, maybe for one property in your whole application, just do it in a controller, it's easier. And I think, let's go to the chat and let's see what John Paul said.
Yeah. So while you are reading the question, Jose, and then mm-hmm. we give an answer to Jan Paul, and I still want to show a little bit of localization of anything and anything else that the community asked on the chat. But first, I want to say thank you to Martin, DevExpress MVP, to show here in our community stand up. But when Martin joined the meeting, I remember one thing. If you want to get really good in SAF Blazor, the first thing is, again, you need to learn how ASP.NET Core works, because Blazor are ASP.NET Core application. A plural site has great courses about Blazor and ASP.NET Core. But one thing that I want to emphasize, the platform, of course, if we're doing SAF Windows, SAF Web Forms, and Blazor, there are going to be differences between the platforms. And one of the differences, for example, like in the, if you use a value manager in Windows, will be a static variable. If it's a web, it will be a session in the session and so on. But in Blazor application is a scope service. That means that it's only running that Blazor application for your circuit. And Martin, he was able to create a new Blazor application and have some type of two two Blazor applications. One that it will be an admin, and two that it will be like the user. So it's a really crazy experiment, but I really, really enjoyed seeing it, the image or the GIF that he, the video that he showed doing that. So again, thank you for that.
Okay, I have an answer for Jean Paul. Please. I don't have code for it, but I know what we can implement, and maybe we'll do it in a video. Maybe we can invite him to join us in one session. So the idea is like this, Jean-Paul. There is an interface for complex property editors. And if you use that interface, you will get a reference to the whole object that is representing the property. So in that case, because I think that I wanted to do whatever you just said, is like, you want to put some attributes in the properties that you can read in the property editor to change it with the attributes that you said. So yes, it's possible. We don't have an example right now, but I've been through that path before. So for example, you can put a map, and if you put some attributes, you can put the startup location of that map. You don't have to do it in the values of the property. So yeah, you can extend it like that, and I guess it's a good topic for a video. We will do definitely one.
Nice. So a few more things. There is a question on the chat about if we can replace the icons on the SAF Blazor UI. Definitely, you can replace icon as you do in WinForms. And again, all these actions that doesn't have an icon, you can put an image. Of course, you can change themes, and there are a lot of really neat themes here. And not only that, you this is all about how good are you in CSS. You can, the login screen, you can put it to the right, you can put it to the left, you can change the background, you can make this as beautiful as you. And if we show the card view list editor, we can put any HTML there. So it's as beautiful as you can actually put it. And we actually have, for another project that we cannot show right now, but we can actually have how to change, and Manuel showed it last time when we were talking about UI customization, how to put the picture of the user here, and even actually store that picture in something like Blob Storage or Dropbox or something, so you only save in your database the link and just replace it here. And because we are in web, you can do a cache of that picture, and there are a lot of neat things. So let's talk about localization, because I think that that's one of the other really important part. Because for us here in the US, and I don't know Dave in Canada, but pretty much here is always English, and they don't care about anything else. But Europe have they have too many languages in a really, there are four countries, one beside the other one with different languages, all of them. So localization becomes a huge issue. So right now, SAF Blazor still don't have means to do localizations like we do in WinForms and WebForms. So what can we do? So the first thing is that we have to see that Blazor Control, they do have localizations already. So you can actually localize all your controls. That means that if we go to Blazor server here, we can change the culture and put here on the host on the Blazor server, and we go to the startup and add the supported localization. And if we see in this project that we're showing here, if we go to the startup, we go to the middleware, and right here we have the localizations, and we're gonna pass the Spain, that's Spanish of Spain. And if we go to the host, we have again as well here to change the culture. And then if we go to the Blazor server project file, we have the Blazor.s, so it knows where to get it. And if you go here, everything is in English still, because SAF still don't have that means. But if I open, for example, the birthday control, January, this is enero in Spanish, February, so all of these controls are already localized to the Spanish language. The other thing that you have to do, and it's cumbersome, because there are a lot of actions and there are a lot of places, but if you have not a really big application, I think that is doable, and you can put something in your customer hands right now. If you see here, I went in the model and I look for the safe action, and I changed the caption to guardar, that is in Spanish. It's not the most ideally, but at least you can get something right away. So you can change, if you see here, it says cliente, because I also in the model changed the customer to cliente, that is in Spanish. So you can start changing new to nuevo and all of those actions, layouts, views to the language that you want. And the controls, again, are already taken care for the Blazor localization service. So not perfect, but at least you can put something already in your client customer. And I think that the way to go about SAF Blazor, it should be step by step. For example, we decided let's do an application if you have just for HR, so they can put pictures and add some other comments or notes to the work order. So the main application is still WinForms, let's say, and we do a small application, web application, and then we put everything together and we do a really big one. That is the end goal.
Javier, I will take the microphone for a little bit, and I also send you a message in WhatsApp. We have a question in the Facebook group. So it's also about localization. So okay. In the meantime, for the sufferers that speak Spanish, we have a podcast every Thursday. And the topic and the last topic that we did was basically localization for all.NET. So if you're interested in knowing how localization works in .NET world, I mean in C#, Visual Basic, and all the language supported, check the episode. I mean, I put the link there in the chat. Sorry for the English speaker suffers. We have that in Spanish only. So if you want to practice your Spanish, it's also there. Okay, so did you check the question, Javier, in the chat?
I'm looking for it.
I sent you a picture of the question on WhatsApp anyway.
So it's saying, how can we set the language according to the logged in user? So again, that's a little complicated right now because that's not, SAF still doesn't have all the means for localization. So we're doing localization of the Blazor controls, and then we are doing everything on the model. But I believe that if we are saving the model difference in the database, and we are able to put this model difference in Spanish for this user and this one for in English and this one, I think that is achievable. Right now, there is not a step-by-step guide that I can give you. I can say we can localize the controls with the satellite assemblies and we can go to the model and change the captions. That's what we have right now. So again, I believe that there should be ways around. Again, if we see in the host, we can are even saving a cookie, what is the culture of the current user. So I think that playing with this a little bit, we are able to get the user and maybe get the language of the operating system or give them something they can choose and save that in a cookie and use that cookie to populate the new model difference or something like that. But that will be my suggestion. Not, what do you think, Jose? You're in mute.
Yeah, well, I think that, yes, you said there is no guide right now, but we can also include that in our, because we do a lot of research with Javier. So whatever you're interested in is like, you just write it on the chat. We will go check the chat later and maybe try to make an example if it's possible at this moment. Also, there is one thing that I would like to highlight in this case is that Blazor in general is using the design pattern for localization that .NET uses, but there are some new stuff. For example, a middleware service and another, like the cookies also. You set the language in the cookie. So I guess, Javier, we will do a Twitch for that because it's a big topic to cover. I mean, we cannot just do it in one moment.
Yeah, perfect. And just repeating the information, I think that repetition is the way that you never forget something. 20.2.5. Test message, and now you will have your success, your warning, and your error touch notification. So that's really neat. Or everything that we just showed before, it was just a workaround. This is the official way of getting it done. So besides that, we talk about tooltips. Again, designers in .NET Core and .NET Standard Project are still not there for view controller, for model designer. You can do all of those in code. I actually once put a survey on the Facebook group and everyone used the model, but they don't use too much the designer for the module or the view controllers and so on. So we talk about the Blazor server UI for mobile and Blazor. The security right now, they release a new example with Xamarin Forms. So I'm dying to test that out. And we put a, let's say, an announcement, so everyone who wants to get a free SAF course could just send us some screenshot of their actual application with SAF Blazor. We didn't get too much response. We just get just one. And I, it's in Spanish. I will tell you, somebody is using SAF Blazor to do a accountable receivable and know how much money they have to put each partner and so on. So that's a real world application. And they just put here their, you see, they customize the logo and they put it here on the top and they change everything to Spanish. So if you, if we're talking about localization, you can see here that they did all those localization in Spanish. And same thing here. You see, they have all the actions in Spanish. They have everything they need good to go. So it's doable. It's take a little bit of work, but it's definitely the route to go, at least in this moment. So anything else that you want, you guys want us to cover? Any questions, anything that we haven't talked about? Again, what modules are you missing? What features are you missing? If, again, I think that this, I would like to get as much information about what you guys are doing, what are your roadblocks, what applications are you building? I think that let's spread the word, because again, this using Blazor, that is a really, in my opinion, neat framework with SAF, with everything that offers security system validation, conditional opinions, that's the future. That's, I'm really excited about it.
Javier, we have another question from Fernando. I know he's one of the SAFers who speak Spanish. So Fernando, regarding that, first take a look to the podcast. You will understand a lot about localization there. But that's a common problem that we have, especially here in El Salvador, that most people use Chrome as browsers. And when Chrome connect to a SAF application, it shows you that it's in Spanish, right? But the it sends that you're in Spanish from Spain. So everything that you have that is showing currency or money, it will show euros instead of in El Salvador, we have US dollars, that's our currency. So instead of US dollars. And if you go to Guatemala, they have quetzales, right? But they will show euros anyway, because Chrome will be reporting Spanish from Spain. So there are ways to do that, Fernando, that you can change the thread internally of the application to go to a different localization. The problem is that you will change it for all users, not only for one. So if you can explain more the case later, I mean, or send us an email or something, we will try to do an example for that. Because this might not happen if you live in the United States or if you live in Canada, that you have in Canada two languages, in the United States just one. But if you live in Latin America, where there are like 24 versions of Spanish, and you really need to handle this, because we have this problem in the past. So Fernando, send us an email, try to be more explicit as you can, and we will try to make an example for the YouTube channel.
Thank you, Jose. I have a question. Thank you, Jose. And sorry, Jose and Manuel. I have a question. What is the most stable version on SAF Blazor for a production environment you're recommending?
The last one.
Always, Network always. Framework 2, Netcom Framework 2.1, or 3.1, 5, or previous 6, or for maximal compatibility with components version 20.2.4 or 20.2.5 that you recommend for best production environment.
So for my opinion, and take this with a grain of salt, is everything is about testing. You need to test your application in your production environment as much as you can. For me, for development, NetCore 3.1, for production, Net 5. And one thing that I want to say, even if in Net 5, we already have a CSS isolation, that is really nice because we have the component and we have a CSS that only applied to that component, that is still not working on SAF Blazor because all the libraries is still compiled for NetCore 3.1, not for Net 5. And even if they work in Net 5 perfectly, I'm not 100% sure, but I think that the Razor language is not the latest one. So that means that it doesn't generate the right overload for the attribute for that unique identifier that it gets generated for the CSS isolation. So you won't be able to use that. I'm just dying for that feature to be available, because that will make our life a lot easier. Just think about that. A lot of time we're just going to the, let's open the demo. We are just going here and clicking inspect and seeing what is the hamburger ID, because I want to change something in the CSS, and then we're going to find the class, and then we're trying to do a selector with CSS. It's a lot of work, but if you do that CSS isolation, we can create a component and right away just affect only that one. Because again, this SAF image, if you point that one in your CSS, it will affect every SAF image. It will affect this, it will affect this, it will affect this, it will affect everywhere. So you can not have a simple way to just affect that one. You need to be really specific on your selector. But with NetFi's, that will go really smooth. But again, I went a little bit off track. Production, Net5, development 3.1, NetCore 3.1. Okay, so let me see if or not if we are missing anything else. We talk about the modules that we can integrate the dashboard, we can integrate the scheduler, the maps. We have some way to run jobs in a schedule. We can put all the projects in just one solution. We can create a card view, custom authentication. DevExpress have a really nice sample, and Jose also did a video about it. We can change database and runtime. Few property editor, Jose showed how to modify a built-in property editor, and not only that, how to inherit from one and how to change the settings. We saw the color property editor. This is the one that they use for member permissions. We have the issue with performance in the lockups. We show how to do JavaScript interaction inside the controller. So if you're really good with JavaScript, you will do crazy and beautiful things there. I know that Manuel have done some type of canvas where you can move widgets around. So that's really nice. We can actually use JavaScript, as we saw on the clear the search section. We have an identity server that we can integrate in authentication, and some common tasks. I apostolic did a video about uploading more than one file. So multi-upload, let me see if we can. You see, if we just drag and drop here a few files and they all get attached. And there are really a lot of neat things. Tooltips, colon resize. I'm sorry, I think that my daughter just arrived here. So Jose, can you take it from here just a second?
Yeah, of course. Well, so basically, like, I think like we are over the time. Let's see, what time is it? Yeah, it's almost 1 p.m. here in El Salvador. So basically, to make the conclusions, is that if SAF Blazor is ready for production, it is, but it is depending on your requirement and your knowledge of the pattern, basically. Because I see the boss here. Like Javier's daughter, we call her the boss. So in general, it's like, if you know your requirement, if you know how to go and look into Developer Express source code, and if you know the design pattern for Blazor, for me, that will be how I will measure if it's ready for production. Actually, at the moment, it's like, personally, this is not for the company that we work on. But I think like I will stick with Blazor. Yeah, right, Sarita. Exactly like that.
Yeah, my boss just got here.
Yeah.
So the last thing that I will say that we have not talked about is deployment. Deployment, we have Linux right now. We didn't have that choice before. And we have Azure. We can use Azure SignalR service if we run into really a big amount of users. And we have Electron. So the possibilities here are ended. We can deploy to Windows, Linux, Mac, and the web. How about that? You want to say hi? Okay, if I don't see any more questions on the chat. I don't know if you guys want to cover anything else, but I think that Blazor is the future. We have put here, and we will be adding more and more about workarounds or things that while we're waiting for DevExpress to release the official feature, we can keep moving. And again, as always, thank you guys for being here. This is our vacation day of the month. We really enjoy this and enjoy you guys having taking the time of a Thursday to talk with us about technology. And that will be all for my side, Jose or Dave or anyone else who want to add anything else.
I think we're good. If anybody has ideas for future webinars you want to discuss in the stand-ups, put it in the Facebook group.
Yeah, please.
The getter, yeah, please. Always looking for new stuff to talk about.
Yeah. And also, guys, if you have any doubts, basically, just put it in the Facebook group, as Dave said, because that is the source of our research most of the time. Like, people is asking for this, asking for that. So all questions are welcome, and we will try to go through all of them as we can. So if that's everything for today, guys, I guess that will be everything from my side.
Okay, guys, thanks for coming. Really appreciate it. Any questions, let us know. Any new topic for the new community. Sarita, say bye.
Thanks, everybody.
You guys have a wonderful day. Thank you for being here.
Bye.
See you in the next one.